All right. Since there are no questions yet, I'll just start talking on a topic that I'm quite passionate about, and that is learning how to play guitar naturally, but in a more kind of in a more scientific way. When I was working on easy acoustic guitar, the course, I've done some research, some reading on learning psychology and things like that, so how the brain works. And I've seen some things in there that were funny because I knew it worked like that. I've seen it in my own lessons, so the things I taught my students. But to see it underlined in science was really, on one end, a relief, but it was also not necessarily a surprise. So what is it that I'm talking about? So what usually happens when a student comes to me and we have our lesson, I explain certain things. So I say, well, you have to watch this and that when you do that technique. You have to look at when you play that chord, make sure that your posture is, you know, like such or so. And the thing is that they go home, and then the next week they come back, and you see that there is a lot of information lost. And then when I start talking to the student, usually the story is that they had the lesson, and then, well, they didn't have any time anymore that day, so the next day was supposed to be the first time they practiced, but that day they had soccer practice and other stuff, and the next day they had some other stuff to do, so it was only after 3 or 4 days that they started to work on the material that we did in the lesson. And what happens is that most of what I have said has been forgotten, even though you write it down, the fine things, the fine detail of that explanation is gone. And the funny thing is that I knew that if you just wait too long, that you're going to forget something. I always say, like, if you wait another day, you're going to forget half of what I said. You wait another day, and you're going to lose another half of the half that you had left. So there's 25% left of the original information that I gave you. The funny thing is that I read research on that, and apparently it works like this. If you have a lesson, so whether it is an online lesson within my course or something, you know, the tutorial online from Gareth Evans or whomever, and you do that lesson, if you practice immediately after the lesson, you practice another time, say, the next day, and another time 2 days later, so within 48 hours you've practiced three times, you'll retain about 80% of what you've picked up during that lesson. If you don't do that, and say you start practicing after 1 or 2 days, then you've already lost 70% of the essential stuff in that lesson. Which is, to me, it's crucial, because we don't, not always do we have a lot of time for practice. Sometimes it's hard to, you know, to find 20 minutes here or 20 minutes there. But when knowing this, you can start being more smart about learning. So what you could do is say, well, if I am really going to do this lesson today, then I have to make sure that I'll practice afterwards and practice two times within 48 hours. And if I do that, then I'll make most of my lesson. And then the days after, I can do other stuff. So it probably will not work for everyone like that. So it's kind of an ideal situation. But to me, it's a very flexible way to maximize what you get out of what you learn from your lessons without having to work with Week schedules, month schedules, stuff like that. So you just take it one lesson at a time, but you really try to maximize what you get from that single lesson. Right, awesome. I see that Gareth is here. So there's Gareth, John, a lot of good people here. Awesome. Right, so yeah, that's nice. Like 12, it's getting going up. That's cool. Let's see. I'm learning acoustic guitar since a year and have developed a sudden interest in classical guitar. Can I learn both? Yes, you can. Absolutely. When it comes to learning different styles, what I do recommend is that for the time that you work on a certain style, you immerse in it. So if you want to do the classical stuff and you're just starting it, just for a certain period, do classical only. So for, say, 2-3 months, just work on your classical stuff. So you really get the hang of it. And then once you get the hang of it, then you start doing things side by side, because there are some differences between classical music and the fingerstyle stuff that you see online. So the stuff that like Eddie and Andrew, Peter and Gareth do. So in that sense, So it's you can do both, but my advice would be is to immerse into yourself in one style for some time, really get the hang of it, and then you move on. How did you get how did you get so badass? Oh God. I don't know. It's I didn't have time to shave, and then I start to look more and more like you. And when you start looking like you, you automatically become a badass, I guess. So that's probably what happened. Oh, okay. So apparently the not shaving is a good thing. Yeah. The thing is, I shave, when I do my recordings for the course, I don't want to look like a vagrant, you know, so I just try to, you know, have a clean cut, just clean shave, and then be presentable, nice and presentable. So that's one thing. What I mentioned about the setting, this is one thing that I was, that I think that is something that you should look into if you're especially if you're struggling with time. So to maximize your time, I just use that rule of three. So within 2 days, you have to practice three times the new material that you just did. So let's see. Well, I'm not sure. Does everyone have a guitar with them? Because there's not much questions coming in. Oh, when did you start playing the guitar, and did you have lessons? I started playing guitar when I was 16, 17, and I did take lessons. Not in the beginning, so I started playing just acoustic guitar, strumming easy chords, writing songs and stuff like that. And then after 3-4 months, I started taking lessons. Then I stopped pretty quickly with taking lessons after 3 months, because I didn't really like the lessons that much. And after that, when I decided I wanted to study at the conservatory, really do music for a living, that's when I started to take weekly classes with professional instructors. So, simply because a conservatory demands a certain level, and they demand, you know, certain things, and you need to get into contact with people that are aware of that. And and ear training, stuff like that. So it was a lot of work. And for that, I took weekly classes. So I had an hour a week guitar lesson and an hour a week theory and ear training for 2.5 years. And then I got admitted into the conservatory. Do you have tips for not getting a sore wrist when playing bar chords? When it comes to playing bar chords, look, the most important thing when you're playing is your posture. In the first weeks or months that you're playing, that's the main thing. Now, obviously, you're playing bar chords, so you're not in that first period anymore. What you should do is make sure that your guitar is placed properly on your right leg if you're right-handed. Or if you're in a classical position, then it's your left leg. But make sure that the neck is at an upright angle a little bit, so it's facing upwards. And what you want to do when you have your bar chords is that you don't have to push your wrist too much to the front. So, and the tricky thing is that this also depends a little bit on your hands and your arms. So I'm not sure if you have big hands or small hands. So the smaller your hands are, the tougher it's going to be. But to make sure, just try to make sure that you don't push your wrist too much to the front. So if you need more room to play, try to just push that guitar back a little bit. So you see the neck coming up here, and then it becomes increasingly more easy to just fret that bar chord without pushing your wrist forward. The cage system. The cage system, let's see. The cage system is basically how you can learn from the chords that you already know in first position. So there's, I'll give you an example. So you have, so cage, it's just simply for the C chord, the A chord, the G chord, the E chord, and the D chord, right? Caged. What you can do with these basic chords is that usually when someone says, how do you play a B minor, then you can learn that B minor as a separate chord. But what you can also do is try to figure out how that B minor would be from your basic A minor chord. The only thing is that what you have to know from these basic chords is where the root note is. So for the A minor chord, the A string, there's your root note. So that's the A. So what you want to do then is put your middle finger on first position of that B string, little finger and second of the G string, and ring finger and second of the D string. You still have that A minor chord now, but you're just using your other fingers. And now you have your index finger free to use as a bar, right? So what I then do, just for the form, is I place my index finger just behind the nut. So to me, that's like position number zero, like this. So now you already see a bar chord, right? So what you have to do now is that if my index finger here is an A, if I move my fingering, this chord shape up the neck, to where my index finger is now fretting a B on the A string, that means that this is a B minor chord. If you move up one, then it's the C minor, D minor, etc. So the cage system, how it works is you use your basic first position chords, and by knowing the root notes, you can just slide them up and down the neck, of course, using a bar to represent the nut, so to speak, and expand suddenly all over the neck. So instead of like the C chord knowing one chord, then you know not only the C, but D flat, D, E flat, E, etc. Hopefully that explains it a little bit. It's kind of a tricky thing to do just in a stream, but yeah. Let's see what else. Do you know any good guitar teachers in the Netherlands, close to the east part of country near Germany? Honestly, I don't, but I'm sure they're there. So, yeah, no, not necessarily. If you want, you can take Skype lessons with me. I mean, that's also a possibility. Let's see. I want to buy a Taylor guitar, and I know they're really expensive, but the sound is really awesome. Do you recommend the guitar? Do you find a special stuff? Can you answer the question in German, please? Well, I'm not going to answer that question in German simply because that would take me forever. When it comes to buying an expensive guitar, the thing is that are you prepared to pay the money for it? So when I bought this guitar, I think it was 3,500 euros. It was a secondhand guitar, so it wasn't new. So secondhand 3,500 euros. To me, the price was worth it. I still feel the price is worth it. But that's me. Someone else would say, that's nuts. That's nuts. I wouldn't pay that for it. So the question is, if you have a connection with a guitar, you really love it, you love the sound of it, you love how it plays, and you're prepared to pay that kind of money, then I don't see why that would be a bad thing. A Taylor has a certain sound, but I cannot compare it to a Martin guitar because a Martin guitar has its sound. So Martin guitars sound great because they're Martin. Taylor guitars sound great because they're Taylor. This is a Rosewood guitar, and it sounds great because it's Rosewood. So each guitar has its own character, and one character is not necessarily better than the other, in my opinion. Let's see. Do you remember the first fingerstyle song you ever learned? That's a really good question. I think most of you will recognize it. My first fingerstyle song will be this one. So Nothing Else Matters. That's the first, and I think I learned that when I was playing, 8 months guitar, something like that. So pretty early on, I picked that one up. Let's see. Do you have any tips for cool rhythms on acoustic guitars using special chords and stuff? I think if you want to get into certain rhythms, new rhythms, you should listen to a lot of different music. So when I write and I play, I draw from a very broad background of music. So I have dabbled a little into flamenco guitars. I'm not going to say I played flamenco because I didn't, but I did some. I played a lot of South American music, so Brazilian music, Argentinian tango, Argentinian folklore, other folklore stuff. That's the thing. I did jazz, funk. There is every style has its specifics and its specific rhythms, and the more that you absorb rhythms and styles, the more you have to draw from if you're starting to write things or just jamming. So for me, I think if you want to learn new stuff, then sometimes just look beyond what's obviously always there, which is the popular music. So go look for something new, right? So for instance, for me, great guitarist. I mean, Tommy Mantle is a great guitarist, but if you want to go into a little bit more different genre than, for instance, Pat Metheny, great guitarist, and he does a lot of crazy stuff when it comes to rhythm. A lot of crazy stuff. Try flamenco guitarists like Paco de Lucia, who is, he unfortunately passed away some time ago, but he has awesome music. So just try to find some new stuff to listen to. Hey, Adrian. Let's see. Uh, How long did it take me to learn the fingerstyle technique? Honestly, I'm still perfecting it. So I think the basic technique doesn't have to take you necessarily that long. That's, by the way, let me use this for something else that I wanted to say. Before I mentioned the rule of three, you know, learning to do something when you learn a lesson and then practicing it three times within 2 days. There's another thing that's really important when learning music and learning techniques and really mastering something. And that is that you have to teach yourself, teach your brain to operate on a certain level. So what level do you accept yourself things to play? So how do I explain this properly? So for instance, pretty much every song that I play, I still feel that I can improve it. Maybe it's the groove, it's the rhythm, it's maybe sometimes it's the technique or how fluid I play it. I always find stuff to improve. Now, that doesn't mean that you should go into judging mode when you're playing. When you're playing, you're playing. But when you're studying, you really have to demand yourself to master something before you move on. So when I learn, for instance, I think it's from Tommy. That little part, I could play for an hour. Just that. And just repeating until I feel that the groove is exactly right. Because once you grab the core of a song, and usually that's already in those first bars, but once you grab the core of a song or a piece of a song, then everything else that comes after it, you will hold up to that standard. So you'll play that better as well. Because it's impossible to play something fantastically beautiful, not necessarily that I was doing that, but just, you know, for the sake of conversation, that you play something really good and then suddenly do two bars that stink. You can do that. So make sure that you aim for perfection in the first 2 to 4 bars and the rest will follow. And that's a very important thing. So, yeah, if you want to improve your guitar technique, do it by demanding yourself to a certain level of perfection. Let's see. Do you play other instruments as well? Yes, I do. I play piano a little bit. It was quite easy. It's a lot more... when I look at the piano, everything is just in front of you, and it makes sense. And the guitar, it took me a bit longer to make sense of it. So especially when I was working on theory stuff, it was a lot easier to do that on the piano than on the guitar. I also play drums, and I've done a little bit of saxophone, but that's a long time ago. And luckily I don't have a saxophone here, so I won't be able to play it. Are you writing any new songs at the moment? At the moment, no, unfortunately not. At the moment, I'm working mainly on finishing up the course, Easy Acoustic Guitar, for which, well, I mean, it's a good way in. I'm doing an Indiegogo campaign for Easy Acoustic Guitar, which is my online course for learning how to play acoustic guitar, at least the basics of it, really in depth, and it takes so much time. So right now there is very little space for actual songwriting. What I would love to do, by the way, really love to do, is at some point, once I have the time and money for it, to go to Wales or to Europe anyway, and then get back together with Gareth and do some writing with him, because I really enjoyed those hours and those songs. Let's see, how many guitars do you have? I sold a few before I moved to Canada, but I think I have, let's see, I have two electric and three. I think I have five guitars. So two electric and one and three acoustics. Let's see. What's your tip on changing chords? The one thing that I, well, this is applicable on not just chords. This is to do with both chords and a lot of other things as well. I even see it with my own students sometimes, or I used to see with my students, is that you have to do it really, really slowly in the beginning. So if changing chords is difficult for you, then the first thing that you have to do is why? Why is it going, is it so hard for you to change chords? What's going on? If you find that you're not changing chords efficiently, then you have to teach your fingers to do it efficiently. So for instance, I can switch from C to G. Like, I'm going to be starting now. And this is really slow. The thing is, I go from here to here. There are no roundabouts for my fingers. So every finger goes straight to the place where it should go. But the thing is, you see that I have absolute control over my fingers because every finger is moving, right? At the same time, and I'm doing it really slowly. What usually happens when people start changing, want to improve changing chords, they just start doing it faster, which is fantastic. I mean, changing chords fast is very helpful, of course. But if you're continuing to place one finger after another, then it's still going to take you too much time. So then it would be like this, and then that, and then that, and that's not going to work. So hope that answers your question. Talk about rhythm. Do you have any tips to practice with a metronome? Well, my main tip would be to practice with a metronome. If you're going to be practicing with a metronome, what helps is if you know which strums or which things you pick come together with the click or with the beat that you have. Now, I have on my iPad, I have a guitar toolkit. There's a lot of stuff in there that I don't use. There's like a chord finder and a scale finder or something like that. I don't use those things. But there's a tuner in there that I regularly use, and there is a really great metronome. So I can set it to, for instance, like a drum kit. So it gives you the bass and the snare, like doom, dock, doom, dock, which gives me more sense of that I'm actually playing with music. But to know which strums come together with a click helps, and not do it too broad. So like what I said with that Tommy Emmanuel thing. And just keep playing that over the metronome. And then just trying to keep that groove, improving it. And I'm not saying playing it 2 minutes, play it 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, because you're not practicing to learn how to play and to place the fingers or something like that. You're practicing to play a groove. And if you're practicing to play a groove, then you have to just loop it and keep on playing it. Let's see. What's your best tip? That's a good one. That's like going straight for the cake. What's your best tip for staying motivated for playing? Let's see. That's a really good question. I think I cannot speak for everyone, naturally. I mean, I guess everyone has to find what motivates them as much. But if I'm practicing something that I am passionate about, then that helps so much. So if I'm really into a song, that helps really a lot. But what is also important is that the song, well, now it doesn't matter as much anymore, but when I was still really making large steps in my progress, what is also helpful is if the song that you're practicing is not way too difficult. Because if it's way too difficult, maybe you're going to get there after 4 or 5 months, but that takes a lot of time and a lot of discipline. So if you keep your steps a bit smaller, then you're going to have a lot more sense of a feeling of success, you know, because it's easier to reach those little steps, and your feelings like, oh, yes, I did this, are going to be much more frequent. So finding something that you love, and also keeping in mind your own level, so don't make the leaps too long, something like that. Are you into bass guitars? Yes, at some point I wanted to actually play bass. Let me tell you what I like about playing bass. First of all, with bass playing, it's all about the groove. There are great bass players that can do all kinds of tricksy stuff, but the essential thing about a bass is to lock in that groove and keep it going. That's the most important thing. And I remember when I was at the conservatory, I started to do, I was writing compositions and arrangements for a Latin jazz band that I had, and I would be practicing those bass grooves, and I don't know what it is, but playing a bass groove just like for 20 minutes, you get into this trance. It's really different from playing guitar, and it's awesome. So yes. Is there a certain amount of hours that you have to practice each day? When it comes to practicing and what you get out of it, there's a couple of things that you have to keep in mind. According to research, it's not necessarily always about the amount of time you practice, but is how often you practice. So you could be playing, one could be practicing 45 minutes, and the other one could be playing an hour. But the one with 45 minutes will be doing that in 3 times 15 minutes across the day. The other one do it in 1 hour, like straight. It could just be that the one who does it 15 minutes, then, you know, little break, and then another 15 minutes, another 15 minutes, could get more from it. I'm not exactly sure how, with how many hours and how that it works, but there is some research out there that the amount of times that you practice is sometimes much more important than how long. So that's one thing. Another thing is that it depends on what you want to achieve. So if you just want to do basic stuff, then, you know, you're basically using your practice time for learning new songs. If you want to be the next, for electric guitar, Steve Vai, or you want to be, as good as Eddie Vandermeer, or, you know, you're going to really need to spend some quality time on the guitar. So when I was learning to play guitar, after I think 2 years, I realized I wanted to go to the conservatory. No one goes to the conservatory after playing 2 years of guitar. Usually you have a little bit more experience. So I had a lot of catching up to do. So I was practicing for 12 to 14 hours a day, 6 days a week, for 2.5 years to get to conservatory level. I was really focused, super motivated. And I say 6 days a week, I mean, there was a seventh day, that's of course Sunday, and I would play guitar there too, naturally. But those 6 days, like there, I had like 10 hours really planned in, every hour was clear what I was going to do. And then I had another extra 2-3 hours of having fun on the guitar. So, yeah. So a certain amount of hours each day, I would just say if you do like a half hour each day, a half hour to an hour, then you're really going to get a lot of progress from that. The most important thing is do it regularly. So 5 times a week, 6 times a week, that's a good thing. Do you recommend going to music college after high school? Wow, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. That depends on you. This is not a piece of advice what I'm going to be giving you, but this is, I have lived my life from the heart, right? So, whenever I made a decision of what I was going to do, I always listened to my heart. And right up till today, so last year we moved to Canada, we immigrated to Canada, that was from the heart. I mean, if I would have listened to my head, I wouldn't have done half the things I did in my life. You know, and a lot of things were, to my mind, stupid ideas. Why would you want to go to Canada? You know, give up all your security and right? So, but that's just who I am. So I like to live from my heart, and you get fulfillment out of things, even though there is not necessarily a lot of materialistic things around you. Now that maybe sounds weird because, you know, I have like lights here and a guitar and stuff like that, but so I don't care about materialistic stuff. So I like to live from the heart. So for you, it's dependent on how much do you want to, you know, pursue music, and is music college the thing that's going to get you there? Because that's, of course, another question. Let's see. Okay. Let's see. Can you give some good finger exercises for intermediate players? It's not necessarily a quote, but I've done a lot of exercises, left-hand exercises, right-hand exercises. That was before my finger-picking thing. Although I must admit, I mean, I'm not as much into finger style as the other guys are. So it's one of the things I do, but it's not my main thing. Good exercises are within the songs that you practice, but whether they become good exercises depends on how you treat the music you practice. So for instance, Guthrie Govan, who is an incredible electric guitarist, and I've never heard him, I don't think I've ever heard him play acoustic, but I'm sure he's great at that too. He said that he never practiced or rarely practiced a scale in his life. He rarely did a sequence or whatever. What he just would do is he would listen to music. There would be a little piece of solo in it. There would be a groove in it. And he would practice that until he mastered it. And that was his exercise. And there are a couple of great things about it. First of all, the exercise you're doing, you hear it in a musical context, which is super important, I think, because otherwise you're just turning yourself into a robot. You don't want to do that. So you hear it in a musical context. The second thing that's great about it is that you have an example of how it should be played. So in some cases, there's even live footage of what you're trying to accomplish. So you can look at an artist's movements, fingering, stuff like that. So, so I could probably blurt out a couple of exercises, but I think that the power of simply mastering songs, really mastering what you're playing gets overlooked because of it. So people say, I cannot get that piece right, so I need an exercise. But why will you get the exercise right, but not the song? Right? So that's something to consider. How can you train your... What's your eye color? It's, I think, blue-gray, something like that. How can you train your pinky finger? It sometimes won't do what I want it to do. Yeah, pinky fingers can be like that. What's good to know is that your ring finger and your pinky, I think they're attached to the same muscle. And that's what's causing those problems. So you have like, you could like walk over your strings with these two fingers, index and middle and ring finger. But once you start doing it with your ring finger and your little finger, most people get into trouble, right? So I think it's a matter of really trying to use your little finger as much as you can with songs you play. So don't take the easy way and think like, oh, I'll just use my ring finger for this. Really try to use proper positioning and incorporate that little finger into your playing style. If you would do that, then probably you'd already start feeling differences. Something like that. I am not left-handed. Oh, this is like, this is because I should, right. In Wirecast, I do this via Wirecast, and I have to flip the image, but I forgot to do that. So it looks like I'm a left-handed player, but I am right-handed. So, yes. Because why am I ringer? Watching your videos and Gareth and Andrew motivates me to go on playing. Yeah, well, that's a good thing. That's how these videos should be used. It's like for motivation. If something demotivates you, then you chuck it aside. And that, I think sometimes that includes people. I'm not saying that you should unfriend them, but like some people can have a certain effect. Like there are people that will always look at the, not on the bright side of life, but they look things on the dark side of life. And if you're talking about things that are really dear to you, I think you should be careful with whom you share it. So, you know, motivation is a very precious thing because motivation has got to do with passion, and you don't want that fire to be extinguished, or, you know, so you have to keep that fire burning. So, yeah. It's a kind of a side road here, probably. How you make the white backdrop? It's simple. This is just a white wall behind me. Most of my lights are on the wall behind me. So it's really lit up bright, and I have more dim lights on me. So... and that's why the background is clipping, and that's how you do it. There's some really great tutorials on it, by the way, on YouTube, if you just look for it. He has to go really deep when he answers all the questions. Yeah. I want to know the Andre way. How do you grow nails on your hand? Well, that's the great thing about fingernails. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to water them. You don't have to put them in soil or something like that. They just grow. What you have to do is keep them from getting destroyed. So what helps is that if you have a nail file, or even better, a polish, is to polish the edges of your nails, and that will make them tear off less easily, and it'll improve your tone by a mile. So polish the edges of your fingernails, and the tone of your guitar will transform, I promise you, especially on a nylon string. Let's see. What do you think when you should practice? Should you play the whole song repeatedly, or just Yeah, when it comes to practicing a song, there are a couple of stages. So let's say you're just starting a song. First, you take two bars. You practice them until you know how to play them. You add another two bars, practice them until you know how to play them. Then you start looping the four bars. Once that goes okay, you do another set of four bars like that, right until you have the first verse or the first chorus or whatever. Then you start repeating that chorus a couple of times and feel really comfortable playing it. You know, be aware of your technique, be aware of all those things until it goes really smoothly. Then you start adding new segments, and that's how you build up a song. Then once you have the whole song and you realize that there is a few sections that are not going well, don't practice the whole song. Just go into those sections and just take those two bars, practice them until they are mastered, and then you can practice them within the whole again. Shoot one by an expensive or cheap guitar in the beginning? That's a good question. That's a really good question. Well, an expensive guitar, I don't think that's it's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, you can always sell it, but you never know if you're going to be keeping on playing. So I wouldn't buy the cheapest guitar. What I would try to do is find a guitar that sounds good, right? Plays nicely and is friendly to your budget. And those guitars are out there. And I would like to share a story. I don't know, I think it was 2011. I went to the United States with my wife. It was our honeymoon. And we were in, I think it was in San Francisco, or I think San Francisco. And, you know, even though it's our honeymoon, I wanted to go to Guitar Center because I wanted to buy a guitar for our road trip, because I was not going to be doing a 5-week road trip without playing a single note. So I needed a guitar, and I didn't want to bring my expensive guitar on the plane. So I got into a Guitar Center, and I started, I asked the guy behind the counter, and I said, "Hey, what's your cheapest acoustic guitar?" And he looked at me funny. He was like, "Why would you necessarily want the cheapest?" But, you know, it was just for the holiday. So he pointed me out to a couple of guitars. And the cheapest one was, at that time, was a Mitchell guitar. It was there for $90 or $95. It was, I think, a dreadnought like this one, steel string. And I started playing it, you know. And at that time, I had just practiced like 5 or 6 Tommy Emmanuel songs. So that was in a time that I still had time for that stuff. And I started playing it, and the guitars played nicely. I mean, the sound wasn't overwhelming, but it was okay. You know, I mean, $95, what can you expect? And the cool thing was that within 5 minutes, there were like 10, 15 people around me. And they were asking, I stopped, and they were asking, like, "Whoa, that guitar sounds amazing, man. What guitar is that?" And I said, "Well, it's the cheapest guitar in the store." So, how a guitar sounds is also what you get out of it. So that's how people can sell you guitars, feeling like this is a fantastic guitar, simply because the guy plays on it, but you still have to do the work at home, which doesn't mean that your guitar that you have now is crap. That's not what I'm trying to say, but it's, so a big part of the sound that comes from an instrument, it comes from the one who plays it. That's why I always think that I had a crappy electric guitar, but I imagined, what if Steve Vai would be playing that electric guitar? Would it sound crappy? Probably not. So I would buy a guitar that is, you know, not too expensive, but it doesn't have to be the cheapest as well. So I don't know, for a beginner guitar, $200 to $300, something like that. Let's see. Okay. Well, there's a lot of nice chat going on. When's the next Peter Gergai tutorial? Well, it's part of my Indiegogo campaign. So you guys, if you want to contribute, you know, you're welcome. There are links is probably in the description. But one of the perks is a Peter Gergai tutorial. And I think a few have already taken that one or the special bundle, the $10 bundle. And there's a Peter Gergai tutorial in it. So I will be making a Peter Gergai tutorial within now and about a month. So there is one coming. Do you have any tips on ear training or figuring out the key of a song? I think these are actually two different things, kind of. Ear training starts with tuning your guitar by ear. For instance, you can use a tuning device, but you can also do it by ear. That's your first early ear training. The next step would be to try to figure out, not necessarily the chords to a song, but the bass notes, right? So you hear the song and you think like, oh, which bass notes would that be? So like a... try to find that on the guitar. Then when you get that, then you're gonna can ask yourself a question like, are those major or minor chords? So is it like, or is it, you know, just try to figure it out. So ear training, you can do it in a sense of like they would teach you that in school, like boring, or you can just dig in, find an easy song and just try to figure out stuff, you know, by just simply by listening, grabbing your guitar and trying to find that stuff on the guitar. And when you do that, whether it's the melody, the bass line or the chords, your hearing is going to develop. And in the beginning, it's going to take you a lot of time, but just, you know, save some time for it. Like every day, like, you know, 5 or 10 minutes, just put on some music and try to figure out to find out stuff on the guitar. Let's see. Right. So the next Peter Gergai tutorial is already done. I think. Yeah, I'm sure that Gareth gets a lot of the same questions. All right, so please answer the fingernail question. I think I answered the fingernail question. I did. When are you going to start making fingerstyle covers? That is a really good question, and I think not anytime soon. Probably for my channel and growing my channel, it would be a very good decision to do so. But this year I am devoting to building courses. So right now it's the easy acoustic guitar course. I'm going to be doing an easy rock guitar course, building that as well. I want to do a percussive fingerstyle course. Stuff like that. So there's a bunch of courses that I really want to build, and I could start getting into the fingerstyle covers, but I don't know. Right now, that's not where my passion is yet. So once the courses are there and I get into a bit calmer waters with my life, then maybe that's an option, but for now, not yet. All right, so these are pretty much, our time's pretty much up. So I think it's awesome that you guys were here. Thank you very much for joining this stream. And if you're not following me already on Instagram, then you can @YourGuitarWorkshop. Follow me on Facebook. That's facebook.com/yourguitarworkshop. I'm on Twitter. That's at YGWonline. And I'll probably be doing another stream next week. And from next week on, there is a good chance that I'll be streaming every single day. I will be streaming a little bit shorter then, but it will be on a daily basis. So I look at the last questions here. So what do you think about silk and steel strings? I used them and I liked them, but I've never been able to get them anymore. I couldn't find them. I'm not sure if I would use them now because I'm so used to these phosphor bronze strings with just a steel core in them, but I did use them a lot. And why did you move to Canada? That's something for our next for the next stream. So next week, Sunday, most likely, I'll just keep an eye on social media and I'll be here. Wishing you all a great Sunday, a great week, and whenever you can, if you still feel up for it, then whenever you share my Indiegogo project on social media with friends or family, you know, or followers, then that would be awesome, would be helping out a lot. See you guys next time, and I'm gonna go and turn it off. All right, bye.